Welcome to our presentation titled, Take Charge of Your Testing Career, Bring Your Skills to the Next Level, featuring Jared Richardson. I'm your host, Josiah. Before we begin, I'd like to explain how to participate in today's event. You'll be watching streaming video and content. To optimize your bandwidth, please be sure to close out any unnecessary applications that may be running in the background. You'll notice a number of widgets at the bottom of your console. Here you may view the speaker bio and presentation abstract. Loving the presentation? Send a tweet to @techwell and include the hashtag #StarWest. Also, please send us your feedback about the presentation via our short 4-question survey. Use the moderated chat function to interact with other attendees. We are also available to answer any technical questions you may have within the moderated chat. And soon a short video will play and Lee Copeland will take the stage.
Welcome back. We hope you enjoyed the final day of the conference. Many of you may be joining us for our special Friday sessions. If you're still interested, there's still time to sign up. Just stop by our registration desk.
Quick reminder to fill out the final conference evaluation. Feedback helps us improve and plan for future events.
We know that you're all probably disappointed that the conference has come to end, but not to worry. You can stay in contact and join us on stickyminds.com and agileconnections.com.
We want to thank you for attending the conference. We really enjoyed spending the week with you, and you are now a very valued alumni. We would love for you and your colleagues to join us at another great TechWell event.
Thank you so much, and we hope to see you again next year.
Welcome back. Our closing session, we have some slides. Have some slides. There we go. We do have slides. See, I'm old. I don't know what to do without slides. Can't remember. All right. So, Expo punch card winner. Javier Cardozo, are you here? Yes? Where? Come get your $100 gift card here, would you? If you'll just stop by the registration desk afterwards to fill out the 1099 so that we can tax you appropriately, we'll do that. All right. Wade and Julian, the test lab guys, have some prizes. So I want to give them a couple of minutes.
So thank you, everyone, for participating. We've found around 50 bugs. Team who are distributed God knows where in the world have been fixing a lot of them, and hopefully we'll see big improvements in the app. So we found lots of things to do with usability, navigation, particularly in the app, and we were very, very, very good at crashing the server. They got a bit pissy with us, and thankfully they've made some changes so we don't crash it in one click. It now takes a few more.
Fantastic. Special thanks to TechWell for having us out so that we could do this. Rob Sabrin as well and Gioti were around helping us in the test lab. We had great help from them, so always love to give them honorable mentions. We also have some prizes from the test lab this week, as we've seen some very good efforts put forth, some good bugs put in. We'll start through, I know you by your GitHub or your usernames now, so hopefully you remember your username and can remember who you are. Third place that will come with a $50 Amazon gift card and a fantastic little pin from the Disney store goes to Kalahari. Anyone remember who that is? Is that your GitHub username? Fantastic. I will put that one in my pocket. And second place, this person spent a fantastic time today, had some great organized approach to her testing. Second place that will come with a $150 gift card for Amazon and a wonderful pen from the Disney gift shop. Hopefully she's not here. Shaquila. I'm doing really well today. This is fantastic. And, I was off. First place with, I think, 7 or 8 bugs that were logged over the last couple days. Fantastic finds. S.P. Conlin. All right. I struck out. Well, the good news is I have their GitHub information. I can contact them. We will get all of those prizes. He also got a little set of robots from the Disney store as well, so we'll get those all shipped out to them. Thank you to everyone else that was able to participate. Had a wonderful time. Thank you all for the help that you got, and we'll see you at the next STAR.
Thank you.
Righty. A little incentive here. The evaluation forms for the conference. If you haven't filled out one of those already and put it in our lovely box at the registration desk, if you would do that, you'll have a chance to win a $100 Amazon gift card. So we encourage you to do that. Now, the conference is almost over, but the conference isn't over. Okay, we have a great keynote speaker here in just a moment, but I want to remind you about 3 things. Tomorrow is the Testing and Quality Leadership Summit. If you haven't signed up for that, it's not too late. Okay, you can still do that. There is an additional fee. The Women Who Test conference is tomorrow. That starts at 8:30. There was a typo on your program, but it is 8:30. Encourage you to attend that. Also, REST is tomorrow, the workshop on regulated software testing. We encourage you to avail yourselves of those things. So that's why I say the conference is almost over, but it's not over. You know, we've got a full schedule of wonderful things tomorrow. We also have in Orlando next month, in about 6 weeks from now, the Combined Agile Development and Better Software and DevOps East Conference. That assumes that Orlando is still there and not underwater and so on. Our TechWell is headquartered in Jacksonville, Florida, and many of our staff are concerned about getting home and whether their homes are going to be flooded and so on. And so I want to personally wish them all well, best wishes, best of luck in the challenges they're going to face in the next couple of days. But hope to see you at that conference. Now, to end the day and to end the conference, I'd like to introduce Jared Richardson, who's going to talk about taking charge of your testing career. And let me read his official bio. Principal consultant and member of the core team at Agile Artisans, Jared Richardson's a process coach who works with software teams to help them build excellent software. He sold his first software program in 1991 and has been immersed in software ever since. He helped create the GROWS methodology, G-R-O-W-S, which you should know about, and has authored a number of books, including the best-selling book called Ship It, A Practical Guide to Successful Software Projects, and another book called Career 2.0, Take Control of Your Life. He's a frequent speaker at software conferences and a thought leader in the agile space. He lives with his wife and children in North Carolina, and quite by accident, they became backyard chicken farmers. That's an interesting story he has to share with us also. So let's welcome Jared Richardson.
Thank you, sir.
Did you put your daughter's picture?
I did. I did get a picture. One of my the daughters who made me become the backyard chicken farmer is sitting in the corner. Elizabeth, can you wave? Thank you. One of her bucket list items was to stand on the big stage and get pictures taken, which we did beforehand. So, awesome. Who am I? You've heard the bio, right? Jared Richardson, working with Andy Hunt on the GROWS methodology, author of a few books, some screencast editor for the Pragmatic Programmers. I always put the local user group in here, North Carolina, RTP, but we have 1,800 members. That's a good one to be. A few years back, coach, trainer, speaker, agileartisans.com, growsmethod.com, effective agile teams. But really the most important item in the bio is backyard chicken farmer. Now, I've threatened to put these pictures into talks for years. Lee, I believe the words you used were, don't do it, it'll ruin your career. So we're in Disney, so I thought we'd start with Princess Chicken. You've seen the Build-A-Bear place out here? All those outfits fit chickens, I promise. Yankee Doodle Chicken, because it was the 4th of July, and what else would you rather see on your leather sofa except painted chickens? So, Lee, there's the chickens. Heck with the career. It was a good run. I couldn't help it. Do you remember when you learned to ride a bike? Yeah, taking you back, isn't it? Many, many years ago. Remember how excited you were? Oh, gosh, that new bike under the Christmas tree. Your parents bought you a book. You read, you studied. You took a 2-day course. It's a good course. You got a bike master certification. Then you entered your first race, and you got to sit on the bike for the first time. And there's your father giving you a push. That's kind of stupid, isn't it? Of course not. You can't study your way into riding a bike. The only thing that can teach you how to ride a bike is a bike. That's the only way we learn. How many times did you fall? Once or twice, yeah. You skinned your knee, but you didn't get upset about it. Well, okay, you did at the time. But when you teach your kids to ride, what do? You run them along and you let go. And you know they're going to fall. Has anyone ever died learning to ride a bike? Don't say yes, my daughter's in the corner. When you learn a new tool, scripting, script language, whatever it is, do you study it or do you try it? Well, you study a little, right? You read some, and you go do it. You use it. Experiments lead to experience. Study does not lead to experience. Reading, no one ever read their way into riding a bike. No one ever read their way into being a great tester. Or to put it a little more authoritatively, the only source of knowledge is experience. Einstein might have more. No, okay, yes, more. A little more. So there's only two ways to gain experience, though. And here's where my challenge to you comes in, right? You can learn accidentally or intentionally. How many of the tools and techniques that you use, did you pick up because you were dumb luck enough to work with Alex? Alex got assigned to your team. Alex was a whiz. He knew exploratory testing inside and out. And so you got to work with him, and you got really good at it. Maybe you were a tester and you were lucky enough. How many of you heard Mary Thorne this morning? Yeah, Mary's good, isn't she? If you went to work for Mary, you learned cucumber. But maybe that wasn't intentional. Maybe that was accidental. You happened to end up in Mary's organization. How much of what we've learned in our career has been accidental, dumb luck learning? Did you, Lee and I were talking this morning about pinballing your way through life. If you're lucky, it works really well. But how much of it was deliberate? How much did you go after? Were you a jellyfish that sort of got blown through the water? Or were you a shark that said, that's what I want, and you go get it? How do you learn? So we mentioned the GROWS methodology earlier. I'm very fortunate to be involved with that. One of the keys, the foundational, the cornerstones, is the GROWS, is the Dreyfus model of skills acquisition. So if you're not familiar with GROWS, Dreyfus, got to keep my words right. It's 5 stages, right? This is how we learn. There were 2 brothers named Dreyfus back in the 70s who were trying to learn artificial intelligence and how to program, and how to program an AI. They studied nursing, and they came out with this model. Now, lots of people say this is a horrible model. There are lots of models. They're all broken. Some are useful. I found this one very useful. So as you learn, Stage 1, you need steps. When you're learning to program, when you're learning a new tool, you need somebody to say, do this, do this, do this. 10 print, hello world, 20 go to 10, yay, I'm a programmer. You need those steps. Eventually, you move through enough steps, that, man, if it works right, you know exactly what you're doing. But what do you do when you get stuck?
I don't know.
You get very, very frustrated. You get very mad. You go to a TA. You go to a trainer. You go to another more experienced coworker. But you're not really able to work independently. As long as it does what you think it should do, you're good. But when you run off the rails, no luck. Eventually, you are working. This is where most of our industry gets stuck. They're recipe cooks. Anything in the recipe book, they can do. But if it's not in the book, what? I don't know what season to taste means. I know how to add 3 cups. I know how to add 3 teaspoons. So this is where you've got 10 things you know how to do, and as long as somebody gives you a project that falls into one of those 10 categories, you're great. You are effective. You can knock it out. But what do you do when something new comes along? What do you do when the mainframe transitions to the cloud? You treat it like the mainframe. Sometimes with more success and sometimes less. But eventually, if you're good and you push on through it, you discover principles. When Kent Beck says, test anything that could break, you don't go, well, that's the OS. Anything could break. I'm going to test it all. You discover that a stitch in time saves 9 is more than just a confusing saying. You can get your head around it. And eventually, if you're really good, you know that person that sits in the corner? You ask for help with a tool, you ask help with a technique, and it's easier for her to go do it herself than it is to teach you how to use it. They start to work off intuition. Now, we've put teaching at the top of the pyramid because I don't, traditionally, the intuition folks, the wizards, the geniuses, the ones who just get stuff done, don't think in steps anymore. So what do your beginners need? Beginners need steps. Who's not thinking in steps anymore? What happens to your shop? Segments and layers out. Depending on who's doing your hiring, if you've got recipe people doing your hiring, you get a lot of recipe people that are really good at following steps. What if your intuition people are hiring? Get a lot of really smart intuition people. What do the intuition people think about the folks that want steps? You're dumb. You're stupid. You're thick. You don't know what you're doing. What do the steps people think about the intuition folk? They think that was great. I love that visual. Yeah, they think they're stuck up prima donnas who won't help us. For me, this helps me map out most of the shops I've worked with, and most of the conflict I've encountered ends up being a layering of the. I love the Dreyfus model, and I found I didn't have it in the talk first pass, and I kept referring back to it, so I decided to heck with it, we'll just do it right up front. If we're going to talk about intentional learning, this is how you learn. This is how you learn. Now, there's a few key takeaways for the Dreyfus model. Dreyfus lessons: 1, beginners need steps. We've covered that already. 2, experts need freedom. So if you ask the experts to write down the steps, they're going to resist it because they know you're going to hold them to those steps later, and that's going to slow them down. Experts need freedom to be efficient. Beginners need steps to be efficient. But if you're going to follow steps, you need to know when to throw them away, don't you? You need to know when to ditch them. But most importantly, for the purposes of this talk, expertise don't transfer. You can be really good at one thing and be a complete novice at another. But if you're really good at one thing and you're used to operating in intuition, you're used to just getting something done, making these intuitive leaps, and you learn something new, what do you end up having to do? Steps. Does that feel good? We hate that. We hate that, but that's what you're going to have to do. Expertise don't map. You can be a great brain surgeon and a horrible cook. You could be a great mechanic and a horrible brain surgeon. I'm guessing most of them are. You could be a really good exploratory tester and a really bad performance tester. Expert here, complete novice there. Not only, and our egos don't like it, but not only is it okay, that's normal. And if you're going to go out and learn new things, what's going to happen? Over and over and over, you're going to be the novice. Repeat after me. Take a Zen moment. It's okay. It's frustrating. Drives you nuts. But if you're going to step out of your area of expertise and step over here where you're a novice, it's okay. It'll drive you crazy, especially if you haven't done it in a few years. And our expertise, man, we are really, really, really good. We got all the puzzle pieces fit together. It works just the way we know it should work. on the last project. Unfortunately, today's a whole new project. None of the puzzle pieces fit together. New operating system, Windows 10, El Capitan, Sierra. Anyone having heard of Pangolin? That's what I'm talking about. This is all new stuff. New toolkits, Selenium, Cucumber. Do we have anyone from TE52.com here? The Tellurium people? No? I met them here 2 years ago. New versions, Mercury, HP, not to mention it's a whole new product. Everything, it's kind of the same, but it's not, is it? Everything's changed on you. It's all new, slightly different. For me, this really sums it up. Here's your expertise. Here's your skill. Project one, we learned, didn't we? We got real comfortable with learning. Sometimes these projects last a couple years. So what do you know with the next project? Well, we just get better, yeah? For those of us that are in management, right, that's exactly what our teams do. For those of us that are working, we're like, yeah, I was good, now I'm better. No. It doesn't happen that way. I wish it did. We don't quite go back to zero, but we reset significantly. If you don't acknowledge that, you're screwed. You're a statistic. Are you, yeah. Awesome. You're not an expert anymore. You used to be an expert. I worked really hard to find that graphic. I'm glad you like it. Are you familiar with the Dunning-Kruger effect? Dunning-Kruger says that beginners often identify themselves as experts because they lack the skills to understand that they're not experts. So if you think you're an expert, you're at risk. Sorry. They went and interviewed high school students and said, how many of you are above average leaders? 98% said, I'm above average. Everybody thinks they're above average. And if you think you are, you're at risk. Have you ever seriously embraced that? Maybe I'm not as good as I think I am. I know more than one person I've said, he's an expert. If you don't believe him, just ask him. Are you sure, Jared? Because I'm pretty sure I'm good. My manager sent me to a conference. I must be one of the best guys, best ladies. Well, yeah, I'm pretty sure. I love this graph. So I do a lot of Agile conferences. This is not an Agile conference per se, but there's a lot of Agile topics in here. This is carted out at a lot of Agile conferences. Waterfall, 14% success rate. Agile, 42%. Waterfall, 29% failure rate. Agile, 9% failure rate. Agile's 3 times safer, 3 times less likely to fail. Agile's better. It sure is. It sure is. Waterfall failure is over 80%. Agile, 3 times safer. It's also not even 50-50. Agile sucks too. Would you take your car to somebody who said, hey, 50-50, I can fix it, but if it doesn't work, don't worry, I'll charge you the same amount of money and you can bring it back again and you'll get 50-50 a second time. I'll take your money as long as you want to bring it back. Here's the part that makes it kind of sobering, though. Russian roulette has better odds than software. You're only going to fail 1 in 6 times with Russian roulette. We suck, people. I'm good at what I do, you're good at what you do, but you put us on a team, we're not that good. This is the end of the conference. They wouldn't let me leave. No, I'm kidding. No. Let's embrace it, y'all. We stink. We're back to another Zen moment, aren't we? Let's just sort of, more politely put, our industry is very young. How many of you remember when there weren't computers on every desktop? My daughter's back there saying, dinosaur. I remember before the internet. First time I used it, it was so slow, I'm like, this is never going to take off. And I shut it down and didn't come back for 6 months. Bridge builders have had thousands of years. Architects, house builders, they want to compare us to people who build things. And they were doing this 5,000 years ago. They were building out longer than that. We've had a couple decades. We're still learning. That's okay. We're still figuring out what's going on. We're still discovering what works. And 10 years ago, I'd go to a conference and talk about continuous integration. And I'd get 1 hand out of 10 in the room had even heard of it. Now everybody's doing it. Now we're talking about continuous testing, continuous deployment, continuous monitoring. That's a different talk. So let's make some assumptions here. Let's assume, as the numbers prove, Past experience is not quite as useful as we thought it was. But the ability to learn is invaluable. In fact, with the pace of change, nothing else really matters, does it? Got to be able to learn. Intentional experimentation is the best way I have found to learn. This is the understatement of the presentation. Every project is somewhat suboptimal and has learning opportunities. Yeah. I'm on that project too. So how do we learn? Let's focus on a few areas. And we're not going to start with testing. We're going to start with requirements, architecture, programmers, languages, and libraries. Requirements, and we're going to talk about the expert who knows they're an expert versus the learner. So the expert says, I already know what the customer needs. I'm going to go write the requirements. I'm going to do it over here in a room. I might take a team of other experts with me, but you're not invited. You're just a tester. Stay away. Go test things. Leave me alone. Feedback slows me down. You slow me down. Let's just be honest here. Go away. I'll tell you when I'm done, and I'll have you some requirements. Shoo, shoo. You've worked with this person. The learner, you know, I'm not really sure, but I have some ideas. I'll write one down. We'll discuss it with the customer and see what they think. We'll review it with development and testing. We'll actually talk. How many times have you had someone from requirements come in to discuss something with you and you go, I don't even know what that word means. Can we rewrite that? Can we clean it up a little bit? Let's go implement one thing. Let's verify it, put it in front of the customer, and adjust and try again. Is this efficient? Does this slow you down? This is very inefficient. It's very effective. We get 50-50 when we're efficient. We hit 85% failures when we're efficient. Let's slow down and be a little more effective. In fact, when I talk about requirements, when you have requirements and discussion, implementation verification, that's where we spend all our money. So why would we wait until we're done to actually have everyone on the same page, right? That's normally the demo when we find out we were all saying the same words and meaning different things. Let's include the triad, also called the three amigos. Took pictures of them in a small world yesterday, but the picture was too fuzzy to use. It was a great shot. Before we spend all the money, let's slow down and get everybody talking. The triad, dev, QA, and customer. Who's the customer rep, product owner, product manager, somebody from dev, someone from QA, and let's find out that we can argue about what it means before a bunch of developers have spent 6 months of their lives proving they're right, and then they can then argue with you over what the word means because, doggone it, I just did it, it must be right. Sound familiar? Let's have the discussion before we implement it. Let's get everybody talking first. Let's slow down. Let's assume we don't know what we're doing and figure it out. Architects. I love the architect slide. I am an architect. The last five projects, those were development's fault. They didn't follow my slides properly. Cloud looks just like the mainframe. These three lines are a quote from current client. I'm going to tweak a few slides. Here is your architecture. Shoo, shoo. You guys go implement. You can verify based on the slides later. Poof, I'm busy. I'm billing to another project now. I know you have some questions. It's not quite working like we said it would, but I'm over here. Architects are gone. The learner? Tracer bullet software development, thin, vertical slices, top to bottom. Let's get something working. Get development to force everything up and running, let you look at it, get everyone on the same page with a small piece of work, 2 to 4 weeks worth of work. Don't try to do 6 months worth of work and then find out your definition of UX is somewhat different. Don't let them work for 6 months and then find out you can't automate anything because they didn't put IDs in the HTML fields and they don't want to go back and do it now. How do we learn? Intentionally or accidentally? Walking skeleton is what Alistair Coburn calls it. Thin vertical slices from extreme programming. Validate that the technologies work cleanly. Make sure everything actually works, not just I thought it would. Executable architecture. That's what you need to sell. PowerPoints are great. Start with PowerPoints. Now let's get something that actually runs. And if it doesn't run, Would you like to know after a month or after a year? I'm a cheapskate. I like to know after a couple weeks. If it's not going to work, let's know now. Let's not wait till later. Let's have an engaged partner who works alongside the team, learning and changing as we progress. I'm stalling because people are taking pictures, and I love it when people take pictures of my slides. Tech choices, the expert. This worked last time, or a couple times ago. It worked once, I'm sure. Shut up and code. I used to have that t-shirt. I went to a conference and they gave us t-shirts that said shut up and code, and they thought they were good. They thought those were good t-shirts. I'm like, I know what I'm doing. It's what I already know, so it's what I'm going to use. I'm going to learn something new. I'm going to use it again and again and again. Eventually, it's going to work. It worked once in college, I think. It was a class project. I don't know. 10 years ago. Tech choice as the learner? I don't know. Let's try it. Let's see if it works. Let's code a proof of concept. Let's spend a couple weeks and see if it blows up on our faces. I had a team one time. We were arguing about three different JavaScript toolkits. And they're going back and forth. And I said, let's do a proof of concept. Take 2 weeks each and go stand up Hello World. And one of them goes, it'll take me more than 2 weeks to get Hello World running. And I just stood there, and he went, oh. We can learn it later. We can learn it now. If you can't stand up a server so that, you know, somebody can come in and use it and verify that the stuff does what we say it does, perhaps it's not a good candidate for production. When do you want to learn? Let's do two or three experiments. Never do one experiment. That's called a demo. It's going to production. Do two or three experiments and learn from them. Let's spend a few days. Then we'll regroup. We'll discuss. Why didn't I talk about testers yet? You know that old saying, something about 2x4 in my eye versus a toothpick in yours? It's easier to see the fault in somebody else. But testers are kind of guilty of this too, yeah? The expert tester. I don't have time to learn. You know who won the prizes? They're out at the pool now. I'm kidding. I'm not going to pick on them. They won prizes. I don't have time to learn. My company will tell me what to learn. That's a quote. Company will tell me what to learn. Automate? When do you think I'm going to automate? I'm busy clicking through tests. Why aren't you helping me click through tests? Why aren't you helping me? I once had somebody who'd been at a company for 20 years go to my boss and my boss's boss to write me up because I was setting up a continuous integration system with Hello World tests that took off of his plate coming in every morning and spending half a day getting the nightly builds to see if they still ran. 3 months later, he apologized profusely. But first he said, why aren't you clicking too? The learner. You know what? I've done this by hand too many times. Can it be automated? What's being talked about? Articles, blogs? What is Paul Merrill writing about right now? Here's a tool I learned about at a user group or at StarWest. Can I test it from a different direction? Can I test it at a different level? The UI? Sorry. For whatever reason, that technology is not touchable. What about the layer underneath it? What about the API? What about the services? What about HTTP? How do I get at this thing? Can I automate the automation? Continuous integration was good 10 years ago. And I bring in CI to a team and they say, we're cutting edge. And I go, no, you're not. I was doing this 15 years ago. CI is not cutting edge anymore. You're not doing CI. You're just behind the times. I'm glad you're doing it now. But let's go CI, continuous deployment, continuous testing. This is where you got to be. In our industry today, you work really, really hard, right? You work late, you work evenings, you work weekends, and what do you get? A certificate of appreciation. Yeah. And then you're laid off. Because anybody can work hard and work nights and work weekends. And I can get a team in Chennai who will come in the morning and work, and they'll stay at their office until 10 or 11 o'clock at night so they can overlap with me on the East Coast. Will you do that? Then what's your value? Well, I click really hard. The jobs are going to move, people. I'm working with teams right now that have members in Dublin, Chennai, Dalian, China. One scrum team, and I got people all over the world. You are not competing with people in the next county. You are competing with the planet. What are you bringing to the table? Overtime? That's not good enough. That's not good enough. Hadn't been for a while. Change is difficult, so don't change. Not irony. I mean that. Don't change. Experiment. Change is permanent. Change implies this policy is going to be different for the next 2 years. When you try to bring a change into your team, you're viewing it as innovation. They're viewing it as you're changing me. Do you like to be changed? Okay, you're not an infant anymore. No, you don't like to be. Well, no one likes to be changed. Sorry. But an experiment is short term. If you're on a scrum team, say 1 to 2 iterations. 1 to 3 iterations, we'll try it. If you're not on a scrum team, say, let's give it a month. Let's experiment. Even the verbiage, right? Change is permanent. Experiments are not permanent. It's something we try, but then we have to evaluate and chuck it if it doesn't work. Try experiments. It's an attempt to learn, to adopt, and maybe even thrive. Maybe even thrive. Why doesn't everybody do that? I mean, I say this stuff, right? It makes perfect sense. I kind of control the microphone, and I can set the case up. I can give you the right examples. Why don't we do this? Should you do this? Well, shoot. I had a great little point there. I skipped it. Why doesn't everybody do this? Well, let's narrow it. Why don't we do this? Why don't you do this? White rabbit. What did the white rabbit do in Alice in Wonderland? I'm late. Shut up and code. Shut up and test. How many of you have ever started a project where the management came in and said, plenty of time, take your time, do it right? I heard it happen once. Abraham Lincoln, when he was running for office, he talked about sharpening the axe. There were two people, young man and an old man. And the young man ran his mouth, as perhaps some of us have done in our younger days. And the old man, he kept going, I can chop more wood than anybody. I'm the best. I'm this. I'm that. And the old man finally just said, you look, dude, put up or shut up. Like, okay, 1 hour. We'll see who can cut the most wood. And the young man picked up the axe and started chopping wood, man, sweating, blisters, chopping wood. What'd the old man do? Sat down, pulled out a file, and started sharpening the axe. For 45 minutes, he sharpened the axe. And of course, the young man, who's working harder? Blisters, sweat, chopping some wood. But in the last 15 minutes, the old man ate his lunch, and he chopped more wood in 15 minutes than the young man did in an hour because he stopped working long enough to learn something, to improve, to sharpen the axe. We don't have time to learn. We're not given time to learn. We're told to shut up and code, shut up and test. We're too busy learning to get on that bike. We read a book about riding a bike. It didn't work out, so we chucked the bike and we walk. We're very busy going somewhere. I love to tell this story. There's some guys I used to speak with on a technical conference. One of them wrote a book on mapping and GIS. They're in Boston. They're going to Martin Fowler's house for a dinner. They're driving and they're lost. Have you ever driven in Boston at night with fog? The roads are not like they are out here in the West. They're running out of gas, they're late, and they don't know where they are. And one of them said, let's stop, here's a gas station, pull over. And the guy who wrote the book on mapping said, we can't stop, we're too late to stop. I'm not giving you names, but if you ask me afterwards, I might tell you a few. So do we learn from history, people? Well, that graph I showed you earlier says we don't. Are we dinosaurs? Do we repeat the same mistakes over and over? Are we too busy to realize we're in a rut? What's the difference in a rut and a grave? The dimensions. Are you going to learn from history? I stole this slide from Andy Hunt, but I really like it. The key to riding a bike, ride a bike. It's not study, it's not learning, it's not watching your friend, it's getting on the bike and going. The key to building software, actually build some software. The key to learning is to learn. When's the last time you learned something new? Today, that's a good day. Good answer. Get on a bike, people. So here's intentional experimentation. You find out there's something you need to learn. You went to a conference. You went to Paul's class. You went to Mary's talk. You heard Jim. Actually, you didn't hear Jim. Jim was in the hospital this week. But if Jim had not been in the hospital, you'd have heard Jim. You learn, you discuss. Go study it a little bit, right? Don't reinvent the wheel. Go see what's out there. But then stop studying and go do something. Set up an experiment. Time box that thing. Go for a week. Go for 2 weeks. Go for a month and see if it works. And then stop, study, and learn. An experiment that lasts 6 months is not an experiment. It's a waterfall. It's a change. If you ever look at the GROWS methodology, you'll notice we baked in, identify the feedback, run an experiment, get some feedback from it, learn something, and move into small adjustments. This is a core part of a new direction. Are you doing that? Guidelines for habitual experimenters, make it intentional. Accidental learning is great. When it happens, take it. When it's not happening, set it up and go get it. Make it short, days or weeks. Is it months? Is it quarters? That's a change. That's too long. Make these things short and actionable. Real world. I'm not interested in a theoretical difference. I'm not interested in a theoretical change. How does it help you deploy or test the product you're on right now? Iterative. Again, do a couple weeks and come back to it. Do a couple weeks, learn from it. Incremental. Gosh, you guys know this, but I'm going to say it anyway. I'm going to remind you. When you're setting up something like a new testing framework, should you go in and try to tweak the bit 17 decision tree, you know, all the way at the bottom of the app? Maybe you start with login. And if you can't get login working, then you've learned something from the experiment. Chuck it and go try something else. And once you've got login working, then come in, maybe try preferences. Try basic reporting. Don't go for the brass ring in one pass. Learn a little bit. Move forward. Move sideways. Man, experiments are a source of truth. Books mislead. Conference speakers. Friends maybe overstate. The internet just lies. Experiments will strip away my bias, the toolkit's author's bias. We're not going to talk about sales and marketing's bias. An experiment either works or it doesn't. It reveals the reality of the situation. It might be a great tool in his shop and not run at all in hers. Experiments is how it works. Not how I think it works, not how I want it to work. Once had a director tell me, well, marketing department told us the tool would do this. Go hold their feet to the fire. And I'm like, it just doesn't work. If it's broken and it doesn't work, they can sell it to us all day long. Maybe you don't go pay for it. But this is how it works in our shop, in our environment, in our technology, and our people. It's not what I thought it did. It's not what I expected it to do. Maybe it's easy to start. Maybe it's difficult to start. I don't know yet. We haven't done the experiment. It's too slow. It's too fast. It's great. It's truth. Use it. Don't talk about it. Don't study it for months. Go use it. Go use it. I love the stages of learning. Some people call this the curve of suck. So when you start learning something, there's some improvement. You see that curve going up? That's when you go, yeah, that's what maybe you learned in the talk today because you only had a little bit of time. You're going to go back to your hotel room. You're going to download a tool. You're going to get a demo. And you got better. And you're like, yeah, this works. But then you descend into unconscious incompetence. You're not aware that you suck. Your confidence in that initial learning carries you right down into the pits. You're using bad practices. You're just doing terrible things to the tool. If the people who taught the tool saw what you were doing to the tool, they'd cry. I mean, maybe not on the outside, but on the inside, there's tears. The example I love for this, my daughter, the other daughter, was really, not you, Elizabeth. She was maybe five. And we have a neighbor that teaches people that used to teach classical piano and opera singing. So it's kind of cool. You know, it's a warm spring day. You open the window and you're getting a serenade. You can hear music. You can hear singing. And my five-year-old unfortunately inherited my singing voice, which is to say, there's not much there. And she's on our piano, which hasn't been tuned up in years. She's banging away. She's singing at the top of her lungs. And she goes, Dad, it is so sad. I said, what do you mean? These grown-ups go pay Miss Leslie money, They're like grown up and they're trying to learn stuff, and I'm just good at it. Unconscious incompetence, right? It's like the people who drive and text and say, I can drive fine. It's because you're texting. You don't realize you're weaving.
Yeah.
You're not aware that you suck. But then if you're lucky, you learn enough to realize, oh, crap, I have become consciously incompetent. I suck and I know it. You realize you're bad. Maybe you brought in an expert, you had a trainer, a coach, you had a moment of illumination where you went, all the things they're talking about are what I do. And that's not the positive slide we're looking at right now. This is a miserable place to be. People hate this. So if you're fortunate and you push through it, you move up to conscious competence. If you pay attention, you can suck less. Do you remember learning to drive a car? 10 and 2, watch the hood ornament, keep it on the white line. I don't know how kids today drive. Hood ornaments aren't as popular anymore. How do they keep it on? But you had to focus. Man, I more than once look at the radio off the road, you know, back off the road. Conscious competence is difficult. It's hard work. A lot of people quit because it's too much work. Eventually, you've cleared the curve of suck. You can drive with one hand. Maybe you think you can text. You've moved to unconscious incompetence. Competence. See, you just throw. You're doing the right thing without thinking about it. Now you're where you need to be. You no longer suck. People tend to quit. They either live in unconscious incompetence, right? I've got 20 years of experience. No, you've got 1 year of experience 20 times. You know this person. Or they get over to conscious incompetence. They realize this is not fun anymore, and they quit. They adopt a new technology. It gets hard, and they quit, and they go back to what they always knew. Go back to what they always knew. What are you going to do? No pain? No gain. Okay, I can't do that either, but still, the principle applies. Get comfortable being uncomfortable. Grow or die. Learn or die. If it's not hurting, you're probably doing it wrong. If it's not hurting, you're living in what you already know. You're at the top of the pyramid, but the mainframe is not as popular as it once was. It's time to move on to something else. So now what? Well, intentional experimentation is good. Deliberate learning advances your career. So what can you bring to the table that somebody who will work 18 hours a day can't bring to the table? Maybe it's what you learned at the conference this week. Maybe it's innovation. Maybe it's something you can intentionally experiment with and learn. Bring something new to the table. Don't wait for someone to tell you what to do. What if they don't think of it? Well, they'll fire you and someone else will think of it. What should you learn? Well, beginners need steps, yeah? I brought steps. If you look at the roadmap, citation at the bottom, hard to read. Somebody did a study of college students, and they laid work out ahead of them. And they found if they visualized it with something as dumb as a silly little roadmap, the number of people who would actually finish the work was like 80% higher. There's all kinds of different ways our brain works. We're still figuring that out too, just like software, but let's use a roadmap. Okay. You're stuck with it at this point. I mean, you know, it's, sorry, my slides. Continuous integration. Who's using CI? Who wishes you were using CI? Good. All right, here you go. You build, stay clean. Ooh, how many times have developers told you nothing changed, but you know. Continuous integration shows you what changed. Now, you may not understand all of it, but when there's 17 code commits and they said nothing changed, something changed. Now you can see it. It encourages project hygiene. Man, there is nothing quite like knowing everybody on the team can see every code commit to keep a developer honest. Do I need to test anything else? I don't know. 235 code commits. Maybe. Jenkins? Open source. I'm a cheapskate. Come through too many startups. Man, I don't want... I mean, there's some good commercial tools, too. If you have one, that's great. But if you don't have one, let's get started cheap. It's open source. It's got a nice UI, easy setup. Bam. Step number one, visit jenkins.io. Yeah, that's a URL. I don't know. They keep coming up with the new extensions, right? Jenkins.io, that's actually it. Click the link that says docs. Read them. Read use cases. Again, that is the URL. Install it locally. There are GUI installers for every operating system out there. Monitor anything. I've had testers who go, ooh, I was running this with Windows Microsoft Scheduler. So they took it out of Microsoft Scheduler, ran it in Jenkins. Just a different way to execute something. Monitor anything. Run a demo for your teammates. Ben Franklin, you want to make a friend, ask a favor. You want to kick off a build, go grab a developer and say, hey, I'm trying out this new project. Would you help me? You know how to do it yourself? Skate on past them. Share it with your team. Here's some steps. Virtualization. This is a buzzword, yeah? Again, Paul Merrill tweeted something about buzzword bingo, and virtualization was on his list. And I'm like, thanks, Paul. It's in the slides already. Run multiple operating systems on your computer. I mean, in a window. Sorry, this is cool. This is, I like this. So you can run a safe testing environment. You can pause it. You can back it up. Pause it, copy it to another place, get in there and wreck it. Then restore it and spin it up again. This is cool. So how do you do it? Docker's the cool place to be these days. So go to docker.com. Click the link that says, what is Docker? Read that. Click on the Get Started tutorial. Install it locally. Again, GUI installer. Download it. Click through it. Here's where it gets cool. Go to command line and type docker run hello world. And it'll go out to the Docker server, and it'll pull down a Linux install with just enough to run hello world at the command line. You've just installed a whole OS with that one line. Sorry, that's cool. Some of you are going, wow, and the rest of you are going, he's crazy. Well, both can be true. Then go to hub.docker.com. So they host lots of operating system definitions. At hub.docker.com, type, see how we're tying this together with the previous slide? Docker pull Jenkins. Now you just downloaded enough of a Linux instance to run a pre-installed Jenkins instance. Is it working well? Good. Pause it and stick it up on a server. It runs for me is now good enough if you're actually running it in Docker. That's another discussion. Share it with your team. You notice how I keep coming back to share it with your team? If you're learning things and you're not teaching them, do you get credit? Do you look like an innovator if you're doing a really good job of testing but no one else in your team's getting any better? One of the books I wrote a couple years ago, Career 2.0, I say write, speak, teach. You don't have to be great, but in preparing to write, speak, and teach about something, you learn so much, and then you're the perceived market leader. You're the perceived expert. Share it with your team. Behavior-driven development. How many of you have cucumber class this week? Yeah? A few? Here and there? Describe the project features in English, and it's now executable. Executable documentation. Executable acceptance criteria. Again, that's just cool. Write tests during a planning meeting. Stories are done when the tests pass. Create a common language for dev, test, product owner. How many of you are familiar with Dan North? I have to tell this story. Many, many years ago at one of your events, I believe it was in Vegas, there was a speakers group getting together for dinner. And I get pulled along. It was the first time I'd gone to Vegas for Lee. And we're sitting around the table, and I get introduced to this lovely gentleman named Dan. And Dan goes, what do you do? Oh, I do this. I'm a coach. I'm a trainer. I'm putting on a conference in North Carolina. Oh, what is it about? Agile software. Behavior-driven development. Oh, he says. Who's speaking on that? That was one of my friends from D.C. And he said, I wonder what he's going to say. And I went, oh. So I spent 15 minutes explaining behavior-driven development and cucumber to this lovely gentleman named Dan. Later, we swapped business cards, because this is back when you did that. And I went back to my hotel room to type him into my contacts database, and it said Dan North, the guy who invented the term behavior-driven development and wrote the first version of cucumber. So from time to time, I like to tell people, I introduced Dan North to cucumber and BDD. They go, really? I said, yeah, about 5 years after he invented it. So go to cucumber.io, read the docs, read the installation, then go to YouTube. Just type in cucumber tutorial. There's so much content. Cucumber is open source. There's no license. One of my clients right now is transferring from a really nice, professional, expensive testing tool to Cucumber because they ran into a problem where the testers and the developers both couldn't run the stuff on their desktop. They couldn't afford enough licenses to do it, so they're transitioning to this. Free's good. I'm a cheapskate, I'll admit it. Grab your tutorials, download it, run it locally. Grab a developer. Again, you want to make a friend? Ask a favor. Hey, I've got this new testing tool. The thing about Cucumber is you write something and you run it, and it says, hey, this piece of code is missing. Here's a sample you can cut and paste. Developers love that stuff. They love cut and paste. They won't admit it. They all cut and paste like crazy. Partner with dev, get it running. So once you have that basic test going and they've put the plumbing in that it said, here's the code, you can then go write variations on that test and use the same plumbing. That's cool. Then what do? You have a lunch and learn, and you share it with your team. Who's now the expert on Cucumber? You are. Yeah, that's cool. Web browser automation. Verify your product in the web browser. Use free open source tools. Avoid licensing. I'm cheap. Use a bundled IDE. How many of you know Selenium? There should be all the hands. Fortunately, we have a roadmap. Go to docs.seleniumhq.org. Yeah, it's a long URL, but you know, once you're there, you got it. Read documentation. Select your team's language. This is what I love about Selenium. It's got bindings. You're a Java team? JUnit. You're C#? Sure thing. Python? Okay. They don't care. You don't have a language? No problem. We have our own. It binds. It slices. It dices. Read the introduction. Install IDE in Selenium 2. It's a plugin for a browser. Go browse. Go to CNN.com. Type search. Do your thing. Record it. Add a few validations. Demo for your team. Is this the right roadmap for you? I don't know. But I got you a couple. Pick one. Assume what you just learned, not in this talk, last year. Assume what you just learned still works, and you're just going to end up being a statistic, guys. This is brutal, right? But this is the world we live in. Question everything. Question constantly. Prove every assumption. Run the experiment. See if it still works. See if this tool can be used on this project, in this environment. Validate the choices before they're permanent or expensive. Don't change. Experiment. Short, time-boxed experiments can drive learning. Remember, if you measure it in months, it's a change. There's nothing wrong with change as long as you've validated it with a few experiments first. Knowledge is power. You should have some. You really should. Lay out the roadmap for where you want to go. I asked some earlier, I said, when's the last time you learned something? Someone said, today. That's right. But you learned a lot of things this week, didn't you? So you know what happens to a fire when you put too many irons in the fire? Fire goes out. Don't go back and try to do 15 things. You learn 15 or 20 good things, I guarantee it. Pick one, pick two, maybe three. Don't go back and try to do 15 things next month. Pick something. Lay out your own roadmap. Make it visual. Put it on the wall. Follow a plan. Until the pinball bounces in a different direction, discard it. Don't get your ego caught up in your plan, okay? I had a 5-year plan. After about a year, I was far enough along it no longer applied. I ditched it, made another 5-year plan. Ran that one for 6 months. Take the plan, use it, ditch it, and this is the end of the conference, not of the talk. What have you learned? What are you going to do? The beginning of your next step. No one's going to lay it out for you. If you wait for your management to do it, it may be a while. Where are you going to go? I just want to remind you, who have you learned from this week? A few of these people, I hope, right? Maybe Bob, maybe Mary, maybe Lee. You learned a lot of stuff. What are you going to do? How many of you are here with people that you work with? So when you're done, now, go have lunch, eat with them. Tell them what you're going to do in the next quarter. Get someone to hold you accountable. Those guys started in these seats. They listened and learned. So what are you going to do? What choices are you going to make? What are you going to learn this year? And then submit a talk to Lee for next year and come back and teach us. What are you going to learn, folks? You don't have to, though. You really don't. This can just be another cool location, yeah? How many of you flew in for this thing? In Southern California? Yeah, uh-huh, that's right. I love Southern California. It's cool here. It's low humidity, great temperatures. I mean, there's bars on the windows, and the traffic's bad. Okay, I love the temperatures, but you know what? You can just go home. You can tell your boss, this was great. I want to go to Star East next, because I like Orlando. I mean, because I'm learning so much. Nobody's going to make you do anything. You got to make you do it. You going to do it? You going to do it?
Yes.
All right. I gave you a blank roadmap. Go fill it out. Thanks.
Wasn't it? Thank you, Jared. Appreciate it. Blank roadmap. We all have one. Hope you'll use it wisely. The conference today is over. Remember that if you're attending the summit tomorrow, there's a reception that starts in about 5 or 10 minutes to get you going, get you ready for tomorrow. If you're not going to do the summit, remember rest tomorrow or women who test. Conference isn't over yet. But I'm done. I'm going to go play with the kids and grandkids at the pool. Have a good evening. Have a good conference. Come back next year and see us. Bye-bye.
We've enjoyed sharing the StarWEST experience with you through StarWEST Virtual. If you missed any presentations, don't worry. The event will be on demand for 3 months for your viewing. If you save documents to your virtual briefcase, please don't forget to download or save your material. And for those participating in our games, we will notify winners by email. With that, my job here is complete. I hope you've enjoyed all of our presentations and the StarWEST Virtual experience. Have a great day, and we hope to see you at all of our future events.